We want to welcome you to the Busti Church of God this morning. It's good to have you with us and joining us today. I just wanted to go over a couple announcements before we start the service and also just remind you about the offering and ways that you can give now that we're remote again. So the first announcement is we're going to be rebooting the Food for Heroes. If you remember, we did that at the beginning of the pandemic, and that went over well. But you know, as the numbers have grown in this area, the need is even greater as far as feeding the workers in the hospitals and in the nursing home. They've been working long hours, oftentimes not even to be able to grab a bite to eat. So during this time of increasing COVID cases, we have decided to resurrect this Food for Heroes to support our hospital staff and nursing homes. So if you can help us support this financially, mark your gift, Food for Heroes, on your envelope or however you want to give that. Also, we would like to bring some cards to nursing home residents as well to encourage them and lift their spirits up. So if you have some time and you would like to make some cards, you can drop them off to us here at the church in the office or drop them in the drop box outside in the drive-thru. But we want to encourage you to do that as well. We also are doing church online, obviously, during this time of high COVID numbers. We will not be having in-person gatherings, as you know. Our services will be online and on YouTube channel, our YouTube channel, on Sundays at three different times, at 9 and at 11 and at 7 p.m. All small groups will also move to online meetings. So if, you know, some of us have started coming back to the small groups here at the church, I just want to mention that, hey, you know, everything is going to be remote for a few weeks. So the church offices are closed now through January 4th. And if you need anything, though, please call the church office and it will be transferred to one of our cell numbers where you'll be able to get a hold of one of the pastors. So just letting you know about that. Also, Christ's birthday offering. This year, our offering is going to support the Stevenson's missionaries in Uganda. We had a matching offer up to $2,000. And so we'd love to send $4,000 to Uganda. So far, we've collected $1,424. We're almost to our goal of $2,000. And we have until December 31st to make that happen. So if you would like to see that and give to that, and you know, feel free to do that. Also, you know, ways to give on your app, on your phone. You can mail it to the church, obviously. You can drop it in the drop box outside in the drive-through there. We'll be checking that. But those are all ways that you can give still. You can also go through online on bank bill pay as well. But again, thank you so much for joining us today, and we know that you will enjoy this service.
Good morning. Would you please join us in singing Joy to the World?
Oh,
Even though we're physically apart, we are connected through our faith and our agreement in prayer. So today, just as every Sunday, we take this time to join together in prayer over our loved ones and even those that we don't even know and personally, but are asking, they're asking for your prayer support. So our prayer focus this week are Phil and Tammy Dole and their family, Michaela Lewis, the Tree of Life Evangelical Lutheran Church, and Beverly's that are serving in Sri Lanka. We also want to remember the Ferguson family and Hal and Debbie as they're just going through some challenges this week, as most of you know. And so Hal is in the hospital, and we want to be praying for his healing and just that they'll know how to best treat him. And then for Sharon and Al Richards, we have been praying for Sharon this past week as she had surgery on Monday, I believe, and she's home now and doing well, but that she will recover and her ear will heal completely. So would you join me in prayer this morning? Dear Heavenly Father, we are still and hopefully always in awe of your coming to earth to save us. We've celebrated this past week and reflected on your love to us. So we think about that even now as we join in prayer together. We bring before you those whom we just mentioned. You know their needs, Lord, the healing that they need, your comforting presence in their homes or even in hospital rooms. So many needs today for so many different reasons, represented in our church family, in our friends, in our family. And Lord, it just comes down to we need you. We needed you, and you answered that need years ago when you came as one of us to be our Savior and our sacrifice. Lord, we cannot do this life alone. We thank you for walking beside us or maybe even carrying us at times. Thank you for meeting our needs today and tomorrow. Because of that, we know we can trust you. God, in this next few moments, I pray that you would open our hearts and our ears today to your word, continually change us to be better, and to be more like you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Some of you no doubt had a big Christmas dinner. In fact, some might have even called it a feast. And usually with such a big dinner, there are a mountain of dishes, silverware, cups, and pots and pans that all need to be washed when the dinner is over. In fact, just the other day when I reached for the last item to be washed, I made the comment, "Hey, this is the one we've been looking for. It's the last one." Well, as we prepare to turn the calendar to 2021 at the stroke of midnight this coming Thursday, I think it's safe to say that for many of us, the words that we will speak when we wake up on the 31st is, "This is the day we've been looking for. It's the last one of 2020. You know, even though we know that 2021 is going to start much the way that 2020 is ending, there still is some hope that when all is said and done at the end of 2021, a year from now, we will have seen the mark of the end of this pandemic. It's as if we stand before a huge door. You see, what's behind it is largely unknown. But we stand at the door and we bravely pull at the handle with all of our might, hoping for something without masks and without social distancing. We long for something precedented because we are so tired of unprecedented. But I want you to listen to me very carefully, because on the other side of 11:59 on December 31st, 2020, the light is on. God is at home and he is calling us to come in. The door is open. Years ago, I read this really insightful statement, and here's what it says. We need not fear tomorrow or borrow of its care, because the one who holds it in his hand has already journeyed there. You know, that's kind of the sense of the passage that I want to use to guide our thinking today. I'm going to be reading from Revelation chapter 3, verses 7 and 8, and Jesus is speaking. Here's what he says. "These are the words of God, who is holy and true, who holds the key of David. What he opens, no one can shut, and what he shuts, no one can open. I know your deeds. See, I have placed before you an open door that no one can shut. I know that you have little strength, yet you have kept my word and have not denied my name. You see, Jesus spoke these words to John, who was exiled in the Mediterranean Sea on an island. And the message was supposed to be passed on to a congregation in the thriving first century city of Philadelphia. No, not the one in Pennsylvania, but the one in Asia Minor. Not the one with the cracked bell, but the one with a cracked and crumbling moral foundation. And we can identify with that, can't we? I mean, many of us know what it's like to live a fragile life, to have a fragile faith that's easily broken. I mean, just the vitriol that we have seen in this past year between people of differing political and social views, even people who profess Christianity. The failures of marriages indicate it. The level of verbal and physical abuse that has grown during this pandemic. I mean, when life is hard, it just frankly is easy to break faith. And yet in the midst of all the trouble that was going on in Philadelphia in John's day, he gives them this message from Jesus. And here's what it is. I've seen what you've done, and I'm proud of you. Now, Jesus' words of commendation to the Philadelphians are wonderful, but it's not really the high point of this passage. Because the key to this whole section is that God opens doors and closes doors for those who belong to him. And I'm talking about the essence of our faith. It's called grace. God makes possible what we could never accomplish on our own. And that's what our faith is hinged on. No one can shut the doors that God has opened. And the ones that he closes, no one can open them. So as we approach the threshold of the new year, I want us to consider a few of these doors. And the very first one is the door to the past. This is the door God has closed that no one has the right to open. I mean, too many Christians attempt to live on the backside of the present. And you know what I mean by that, don't you? I mean, even though the car is moving forward, we keep looking up in the rearview mirror. We're held hostage by yesterday's events and circumstances. We experience regret over missed opportunities, guilt over poor choices, depression over unmet expectations, frustrations that result from the endless mental games called what if or if only. And those are especially popular this time of year. But what's the use, right? If ifs and buts were candy and nuts, we'd all have a wonderful Christmas, right? But ifs and buts aren't reality. Life is disappointing sometimes. I mean, 2020 has certainly taught us that. We make mistakes. We mess up. But grace says the door to yesterday is locked. In fact, the Apostle Paul put it this way in Philippians 3. He said, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. You know, the door to the things we wish we could change about last year has been shut behind us. We can't live there anymore. If you willingly or unwittingly chose a path you knew was not in keeping with God's will, just confess it and move forward. It's a door that God has shut, and no one can open it, not even you. And when we try to pick the lock and sneak back where we don't belong, it's often because we want to try to rewrite our history or rationalize our actions or punish ourselves as a sick way of feeling better about being forgiven. But hear what John said, forgetting what is behind. In other words, let your past remind you, but don't let it define you. Well, this leads me to the next door, and it's called the door to new beginnings. This is one of those doors that God has opened and no one, absolutely no one, can shut. And when the Apostle Paul wrote to the Philippian church about forgetting what is behind, he didn't stop there. He went right on without taking a breath. He adds, and straining forward to what is ahead. The back door might be locked, but thank goodness the front door is wide open. And that's good news. That's grace. We are not only freed from the guilt and regret as from the things that are in our rearview mirror, but we're blessed with a second chance. I mean, leave it to Paul to put it in language that we can understand. In his second letter to the church in Corinth, he wrote, "If anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone and the new has come." In his unexplainable mercy, God has planted in each one of us the opportunity for a fresh start. You know, Jeremiah is another one through whom God spoke this message of mercy. And we looked at this passage just weeks ago as we've been going through the story. He said that the love of God never ceases and his mercies never come to an end. In fact, he said they are new every morning. Remember that from Lamentations 3, verses 22 and 23? And that means that they are new at the dawn of a new year as well. The present, you see, is more than just a tense. It's a gift that God desires we unwrap. And it's an open door through which he wants us to move. And it's in going through this open door that we can act on all the things that we've learned from our past. You know, in what seems like a million years ago, I when I was a youth pastor, I did something with our students at the end of the year that I did so that they might think about the possibilities that lie before them, that laid before them in the new year. I gave them a piece of paper and an envelope, and I told them to write what they hoped for in the coming year. And then they addressed the envelopes and they sealed the letters inside. And 6 months later, I mailed each one of those letters to them. And it was kind of a reminder that enabled them to kind of correct, make some small corrections so that they could accomplish the things that they aspired to accomplish in the new year. You know, when we reflect on the account of the wise men, we discover that they went home a different way than they came. And that's really what this door of new beginnings is all about. Returning to the job another way. Going back to school with a different attitude. Beginning today with a new perspective. And you know what? This coming year is the perfect year in which we can replace bad habits with good ones. Well, there's another door I'd like us to consider this morning, and it's also a door that God has opened that no one can close. And this door is called the door of providence. And providence just simply means that life isn't a gamble. We come to term with the fact that God is in control, that all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. You see, we believe his purpose is for good, not for evil, because a holy and yet loving God is in charge, and he providentially brings about his agenda for his world, for his people. And this is a door with a frame that is ornately carved with references to God's faithfulness. I mean, look at all the Lord did to accomplish what he did when Jesus entered into our world. He opened a womb that had known no man. Then he opened the womb of another sealed shut with age. And he closed the mouth of a man who verbalized doubt. And he shut the door of deceit in Herod's face. He opened the spiritual eyes of pagan stargazers by arranging this cosmic phenomenon in the sky. And that, my friends, is what I mean by providence. God's purpose accomplished by his control of circumstances. And those are just the events surrounding Christmas. You see, we can enter through the door of this year with confidence, knowing that we belong to an awesome God and nothing can separate us from the love of his providential plan for our lives. Well, there's one more door that I want to take you through, and it's the door of home. Now, the home that I have in mind is not the one where we live, you know, the address where we live, but rather the home to which fully devoted followers are headed. There, the soft, warm glow of the Father's presence will envelop us in eternity. We'll work together at Jesus' side. Well, the message that Jesus gave to the Christians in Philadelphia concludes with a verbal picture of what that reunion looks like. And it's found in Revelation 3, beginning at verse 11. I'm coming soon. Hold on to what you have so that no one will take your crown. Him who overcomes, I will make a pillar in the temple of my God, and never again will he leave it. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which is coming down out of heaven from my God, and I will also write on him my new name. You know, the door of home is in the distance, but it is there. And I invite you to look beyond the boxes of Christmas decorations that are waiting to be stored again for another year. Beyond the gifts that you might not know what to do with. Beyond the stress and the mess of life that doesn't seem like it will return to anything normal in the near future. Look beyond it all to see the door through which we will one day enter. You see, that's the hope that 2021 will bring. That's what Jesus did. He kept his eyes on the door yet to open. So why don't we follow his example? You know, unfortunately, some of you will continue to be paralyzed by the events and situations of your past unless you reach for that door handle and by faith close it behind you. The good news, though, for this new year is that Jesus has already dealt with the problem. You are forgiven. You are free if you want to be. In the name of Jesus, resolve today to not give in to the temptation to dwell on the past ever again. Some of you who stand at the door of opportunities, of new opportunities, will just stand there and kind of chalk up yet another New Year's message that maybe warmed your heart. Well, I have to tell you that messages like coffee and hot chocolate, they only stay warm for a while. So what are you going to do? Well, I want to give you the same opportunity for the same accountability that I created for my youth group a million years ago. Go ahead, write a letter to yourself, seal it and address it. Then if you will drop it off at the church drop box, in 6 months, I will mail it back to you. I give you my word, and we'll even pay the postage. Follow the example of the wise men. They took another route into the future. They refused to retrace their steps. But listen, I know some of you are standing at the open door of new beginnings, and on the brass hardware of the door handle that you see, that you're looking at, you see the reflection of a jaded Christian. You stand at the door of providence and you feel like you can't go any further. You feel like God has let you down. Maybe a loved one has died, or a marriage has failed, or a business partnership blew up. 2020 happened. You aren't sure that you really believe the verse that says, we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. As far as you're concerned, all things haven't worked together for good in your life. If you're not connected with a small group, please consider giving it a try in 2021. It's a great way to get support from others and to discover that you're not alone in the challenges that you face. And the bonus is that when you do life with others, it actually makes life more manageable. In fact, I want to show you our lineup for groups that will begin meeting weekly starting the week of January 3rd. It starts out with a group that I lead on Tuesday evening at 6:30 p.m. and all of these will be online. This one is for co-ed adults. And if you want to be a part of this group, just contact me and I'll be glad to get you the contact information for that. Also on Tuesday evening at 6:30, there's a group for young adults. So if you'd like to join that group, just contact Callie Stevens. Then there's a group on Wednesday evening at 6:30 for women and also a group for men. And if you would like the information for the women's group, you just simply need to contact my wife, Sally, or if you want to join the men's group, contact me and I'll get you that information. Sunday morning at 9:30, there's another group for co-ed adults, and you can get that connection information from Lana Keller. And then Sunday afternoon at 6:30, you can get the connection information from Vicki Whitford. That happens at 6:30. Well, you know what? Earlier this year, I used a phrase that I want to remind you of today. And here's what it is. Faith is confidence that Jesus is who he says he is and that he will do everything he has promised to do. So go ahead, walk through the door. You know, Jesus was concerned about the church in Philadelphia, and he's just as concerned about you and me. He wants you to know that the keys that will unlock the most significant and meaningful year of our lives are on his key ring. We just need to trust him. Oh, see, the door is opening right now, and I want to walk through it. Will you go through it with me? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that we can count on you to be faithful, to open a door that no one can shut for 2021. And as we walk through it, God, may we discover the vision and the purposes that you have for our lives. We pray in your name. Amen. God bless you.
Step down.